Hi, welcome to this series where I'll be going through the ITIL 4 practices individually, and I'll be giving you the main headline points you should be aware of to help you get through your support and your base knowledge of ITIL 4. Now, this particular recording, I'm going to cover some overall context and some real world examples and real world experience that I have, having worked in this area for around 25 years. So I'm going to talk around supplier management from an ITIL perspective, but I'm also going to talk about supplier management from the perspective of SIAM as well. Now, SIAM is Service Integration and Management. So while I'm going to be talking around ITIL 4 and the ITIL 4 practice and general management, in this particular video, I will also be adding on the SIAM view on this particular practice as well. Okay, so please subscribe to my channel. Click on the bell so you get all the updates, and whenever I update a video, you'll be notified and you'll be able to be kept up to date. Okay, so let's get to it. Today, I'm going to be covering off a favourite practice of mine. I've been doing this practice for over 25 years, so I've got quite a lot of experience from real life experience, plus the textbook and the frameworks around this as well. So the ITIL 4 practice I'm going to talk about is supplier management. And for those of you that are familiar with ITIL 4, you will know that's one of the practices within the general management practice. What's practice? Hopefully this should be pretty well ingrained in your brain by now, but a practice is an organizational, a set of organizational resources that are designed to perform work or accomplish an objective of some kind. So, as I say, having worked in this field for many, many years, I've heard this practice, this activity go by many names, numerous names, and I've heard things like vendor management, supplier management, service provider management, multi-sourcing management, supply chain management, third party vendor management, even product and service management, when I think back to one consulting opportunity with a US organization, and of course service integration and management, so that's SIAM, orchestration management, that was another term that I heard used in a recent contract. So all of those, so terminology aside, all of those activities, those names, The commonality within all of them is about leveraging these suppliers, vendors, third parties, whatever you want to call them. But the term leveraging is used quite often in terms of trying to get value, trying to leverage your position on this. So if we dip back into the ITIL 4 view on life and the service management and supplier management practice. So the purpose of the supplier management practice is to ensure that the organization suppliers and their performances are managed appropriately. I like that word. What does appropriately mean? To support the seamless provision of quality products and services. This includes creating closer, more collaborative, now I'm going to emphasize the word collaborative. There is a difference between cooperation and being collaborative. Collaborative, you have a shared vision, a shared goal, you're all working in one particular direction. cooperation, slightly different, perhaps, you know, a little more selfishly in terms of your approach. But this definition, collaborative, is so important, and we'll cover this off both from an ITIL perspective and from the SIAM perspective as well as we go through this video. So this includes a closer, more collaborative relationship with key suppliers to uncover and realise new value and reduce the risk of failure. So important. So supplier management activities that are central to the practice typically are going to be a single point of visibility and control, a strategy, agreeing contracts, negotiating contracts, managing those relationships, and performance. So if you do a bit of a deeper dive into each one of those activities and provide a bit more information. So single point of visibility and control. So you're doing that so you create and you make sure there is consistency. And that should be across all products, all services, all components, all procedure, all of it, basically. You need to make sure there's a consistency there. And that's operated by the internal people and the external people and suppliers and customers. Just making sure there's an overall consistency there. The second part around strategy, so that touches on items such as contract management information, policy, and just maintaining a strategy. So is there a supplier strategy within your organisation that covers policy, that covers contract management and the information within those relationships? And then negotiating and agreeing contracts. So there may be arrangements, there may be agreements that perhaps need to be aligned across the business. Maybe you're operating in an organisation where a particular supplier may be operating over different regions or different parts of the globe, and they need to be aligned to the needs of the business overall, as well as to perhaps a particular region. But they all need targets. It's important that there are service targets, contracts and external suppliers. You may need to negotiate them or you may need to agree them. Typically, my experience has been involving legal departments, whether that's an organisation. It's certainly in larger organisations, there will be a dedicated legal department. In other organisations, smaller organisations, they have an outsourced arrangement for legal services. Either way, you're going to need to negotiate and you're going to need to agree or sign some kind of contract at some point, and you will need your legal team. Perhaps there's an element of purchasing in that as well. So maybe there's a procurement element. Again, larger organisations, there are procurement departments. In smaller organisations, it's a little more agile, and you know, there may be a go-to person, or there may be an external organisation that deals with procurement or the commercial aspects. Either way, there are going to be different functions of the organisation that you need to be mindful. For internal suppliers, you may even have internal agreements. So certainly organisations I've worked through over the years, and I've come in from a consulting perspective, there are a combination of external contracts and external agreements that are negotiated and agreed. There's also the internal element. There are operational level agreements or tactical level agreements with internal suppliers of services. So don't always think that negotiating and agreeing contracts and agreements is something that that is an external facing activity with external parties from the organisation you're working through, it may actually be an internal department as well. You know, there may be an internal team that provides some of these services to the business, and you need to agree and negotiate internal agreements. The other activity within this practice that's key is relationship management. So managing relationships, and as I've said, that could be with an internal team, or it could be an external third party supplier, service provider. And these should be done when you're planning, when you're designing, when you're building, orchestrating, I love that word, orchestrating, transitioning and operating products through services. So just think through the relationship management piece, and quite often, in some cases, not all of the cases I can think of, but certainly in probably more cases than not, that relationship piece, you work with procurement as well, and the performance management element. The other item worthy of mention here around supplier management practice and activities specifically is performance. So monitoring that performance. Now, certainly in a number of cases, that may well be from an operational perspective. So maybe there is a monthly service review with a service provider, and you go through the service that they've delivered for that month, and have they met the targets and the agreements within the contract, or perhaps there are elements within the schedules of the contracts, service level agreements, for example. So you may well go through those items, check that they've been delivered from a operational perspective. You also need to look at the tactical and the strategic element of that performance as well. It needs to be monitored. You need to make sure that it's meeting the terms of the agreement, that it's meeting the conditions of the agreements, and any targets of their contract and or agreement, but making sure you are ultimately getting that value. You're getting that, and value is not always money. It can be other areas, but are you getting value for money is clearly an important point there. But are you getting the products and the services that they are providing to you in the way that you would expect? Has there been a performance agreement there that says yes, you are delivering what we expected? Okay, so let's just very, very briefly go back to ITIL 3 for 1 second. And one of the ways in which ITIL 4, so the new world of ITIL, differs from some of the older versions, if you like, of ITIL, and I'm talking of ITIL 3 here. So ITIL 3 talked around 4 P's again. And there was people, products, processes and partners of service management. In ITIL 4, this becomes the 4 dimensions of service management. I've got a couple of videos on that. Please have a look around on the channel if you want to know a bit more information around that. But it's worthwhile just being relatively familiar with what is the difference between V3 and V4, and there are other elements there, not just this point around the 4 P's here, but certainly processes and practices and the life cycle, service value system, service value chain. But in the context here that of kind of looking at supplier management, it's worthwhile just being aware of ITIL 3. So if we continue on the supplier management practice, and there's some specific terminology that it's really important that you're familiar with, because you'll hear these words on a fairly regular basis and people band them around and perhaps don't always always know what they mean exactly, but the four words I'm just going to mention here around supplier management practice is insourcing, outsourcing, single source or partnership, and multi-sourcing. And then I'll also talk about some real world experience that I have here in terms of working onshore and offshore for in a multi-sourcing environment, in a SIAM environment. But if we go back to ITIL 4 again, so insourcing, terminology to kind of digest and think through is products and services created, developed, designed, supported, managed. In fact, it's just about everything, including the BAU, business as usual, by internal teams from within the company that need them. So it's an internal function providing services to the organization itself. So I'll just repeat that. Products and services created, developed, designed, supported, managed, all the BAU stuff, so pretty much everything, by an internal team from within the company needing them. Now, outsourcing. So this is where the external service provider or the vendor or the supplier or third party or however you want to term it, but there's an external organisation to the organisation that you're working for, providing those products or providing those services to the organisation, which were provided internally. So Think of outsourcing as the word itself says. They are being sourced from outside of the organisation. So a little play on words there, perhaps. But the service provider could provide one service. It could be more services to the customer. But it's basically sourcing from outside the organisation. In larger organisation, the sheer volume of service providers can actually become really cumbersome to manage in terms of delivering that end-to-end service piece. They don't always play nicely together, for example, or they don't always consider the end-to-end service just their part. So it's not always in the best interest of the customer. So if you just think about that for a second, end-to-end service management is really important. It's really important that you have that in your support model, that you don't end up with a situation where you've got different service providers, different vendors, different third parties arguing with each other as to where the fault lies. Quite often, from a customer perspective, you actually don't care where the problem is. What you're more interested in is that operationally you can't work at the moment, so it just needs fixing. Whether it's software, whether it's hardware, whether it's networking, don't care, it's not working. So that's always been the challenge with outsourcing, in that you may well have lots and lots of service providers providing products and services. Not only have you got the management of their monthly service reviews, perhaps regular due diligence activities, service performance, contract management, renegotiation, and you've also then got the service piece to that, which goes along the lines of, okay, well, you're providing this element or this part of the jigsaw, and that should dovetail into this other organisation, or perhaps that's an internal function as well. And I think you'll find quite often service providers don't provide that end-to-end service. They will just deliver their part, and their interest is about about delivering their bit to the best capacity and the best capability that they have. Why wouldn't they? You know, absolutely. Contractually, they've delivered that service. If that service then dovetails into another organisation, quite often you will find a delimiter. And I've certainly seen contract clauses talking about non-performance exclusions. So if a service integrator, for example, is managing the relationship with all these service providers, it's really important that there isn't a non-performance exclusion element in there for the service level. And what that means in practical terms is if you've got an organisation managing all of your outsource providers, and we'll come on to this in a minute in terms of single source and multi-sourcing, it's really important that you make sure that they can't get out of a situation where if they then rely on another third party to deliver something, you have to make sure that they are accountable for the end-to-end piece, because I've certainly seen that exclusion clause in there that's worth being aware of. Anyway, we're slightly going off track there. The other terminology is single source and partnership. So this is where you are procuring a product or procuring a service from a single supplier. Now, that can be, in practice, a single company providing directly, or an external service integrator who manages all of those service providers. So we were just talking about that a moment ago. And that service integrator is responsible for getting all of those third parties to play nicely together, to instill a collaborative environment in the ecosystem. And the end goal there, the end goal from a service management perspective, is about end to end. So that's what's meant by single source or partnership. It's procurement of a product or a service from a single supplier, period. However, really important point, in practice, that can just be a single company providing that service directly, or an SI, a service integrator. And the goal of the service integrator, the challenge of the service integrator, the skill of a service integrator is getting those various service providers to collaborate. And within this section, later on, we will touch in a bit more detail on what that means and what that looks like, and other areas such as SIAM, where that fits in and how that approaches. And then the other term to be aware of is multi-sourcing. And again, I will cover that later on in a bit more detail. But this is procurement of a product or procurement of a service from from more than one independent supplier. So you, in this model and in this environment, you can have an internal service integrator, or you can have an external service integrator. Slight aside again, a real world experience point. I've worked in a SIAM model previously, and I've worked on both sides of the fence in terms of working for an Indian offshore service integrator, managing the ecosystem for a client, for a customer, where there were lots of service providers. And the challenge there was absolutely one of collaboration, getting everyone to play together nicely, and making sure that there was ownership and there was proper governance there. And then I've also worked from the other side in terms of working for a service provider, and I've also worked for a customer. So a lot of what I talk through here is, it's not just information from a book, it's also, yeah, I've been there, I've got the t-shirt. Another element for supplier management is, I've been involved with RFIs, so request for information, request for proposals, RFP, tenders, due diligence activities and vendor selection activities for decades. And I really can't stress less the importance of evaluation and selection in the supplier management practice. So ITIL4 advises suppliers, service providers should be evaluated and selected on a number of areas. And the areas is importance and impact, risk and cost. So we're going to dive dive into a bit more detail on those three items. And just really to reiterate, it's so important, this area. You mustn't underestimate the importance of the evaluation and the selection element of supplier management. So if we kick off first of all with importance and impact, so this is about the importance and the impact in the context of the value to the business. So I've done this assessment many times, and you need to consider not only the value of the contract. So for example, is it a 10k a year contract or is it a $10 million a year contract? So you've got the value piece, but also it's really important to look at what is the value in terms of the service that it's providing to your organization. So it's easy and it's right and proper to rank and look at the importance and impact from a cost perspective. Clearly, a contract that's costing $10 million a year is going to need more activity and monitoring and risk and, you know, assessment than you know, a smaller one. But a really good example and a real world example of this is that I worked for a large insurance company many years ago, and part of this activity highlighted there was a small contract and I don't know, I think it was about 5k a year, so it was a really small contract that kind of had gone under the radar for many years within this organization. But it was only when I dug into that into a bit more detail as to what are they actually doing in terms of what is the importance in impact, the value that they are providing to the business. And as it happened, what they were doing was they were a very important cog within a phone system. Now, the organization had call centers globally, and this really small little contract that really didn't really get much attention, didn't get much activity at all from the customer, was providing a really important cog in terms of the business, how that business operated internationally for call centers, for contact centers. Now, I don't think that had really been thought through, and it hadn't been understood as to how important that contract was. Sure, somebody had gone through it and said, well, you know, these are all our contracts. We've got this contract's 10 million, this contract 5 million, this contract 1 million, you know, these contracts 100,000. And then as you got down that list, people lost interest, if you like, and certainly something that was about 5k a year was almost kind of, well, it's costing me more just to look at it and talk about it than it is to properly manage it. But that's what that point to me really is talking about, the importance and the impact. What's the value to the business? Be aware, value's not always just how many dollars is it costing you. What is it that, what would be the impact if that small organization went out of business, or if a competitor had bought that small organization, for example? Just think through, beyond the money side of things, the importance and the impact. So rank your suppliers, your third parties, your vendors, however you decide to term that, but right and proper to look at the financial side of things, but make sure you're not missing a trick in terms of the value of the service or the value of the product that they are delivering to your overall organization. What happens if that really small tiddly company that you're only paying 5k a year to, what happens if they went bust? What happens if they got taken over? What happens if there was a major security issue with them? Where does that leave you? I think the answer is exposed here. But where does that leave you if something should happen to them? So the first point about importance and impact, look at the value, but don't get your eyes clouded over when we talk about value, that it's money. It it's not always money. Okay, the second part in terms of supplier management practice that falls into the evaluation and selection activity is around risk. So this does link into the last point, but consider risk in a much wider context. So due diligence, for example. So areas I've typically considered when dealing with vendors are finances. So for example, part of the due diligence process I've been involved with on a number of contracts has been around what's the risk here? What does the risk profile look like in our supplier management practice? How financially stable are some of these organisations? So I've looked at the last 3 years worth of accounts, for example, in an organisation, just to get a flavour of, are they okay? You know, are they in the green? Are they the amber? Or actually, are they in the red? Also, some of the activities I've looked at is attrition, staff turnover within organisations. It's always a good indication in terms of the health of an organisation. Is there a very high staff attrition rate? And I've certainly, the 2 points I just mentioned there around the last 3 years worth of accounts and staff turnovers, those are the kind of items I quite like to see in RFP tenders as well, just to get a flavour of how's this organisation doing. And then doing some digging around, you know, when you look at a risk profile, as are they being taken over? Is there something going on? Are they being taken over by a competitor, for example? What does that mean? If you're in business with this organisation that provides you a product or service, what does it mean to your organisation if that company is then taken over by a competitor? That is certainly a risk. Have you thought that through? Also, items I've been involved in and I quite like to make sure are covered off to reduce risk are things like ISO accreditations or the right level of security. Perhaps in regulated environments, you might be thinking around, are these services SOX approved, or, you know, do they meet the required PCI requirements? Data protection standards. Also, I think, do they provide services to direct competitors of yours? Is that a problem? Maybe it's not, but it certainly, maybe you want to ask the question around where's the data stored and how's that segregated against our competitor? So clearly, if your competitor, if all of the data is in the same place and your competitor happens to be able to get access to your data, that's not great. That is a significant risk. So you'd certainly want to be asking about how is that data segregated? How is that kept secure and safe away from, in particular, this organisation? I've worked for an organisation a few years back where that exact situation happened. And we had to go through a fairly elaborate VLAN activity and different virtual machines for servers and storage. So again, look at risk in a very wide sense. So I've pulled off a couple of things there in terms of finances, things like staff turnover, attrition, what's happening to that organisation in the widest sense? Are they being taken over? What about security accreditations? What about regulatory requirements, data protection? Where do they sit in terms of competitors? And how do they keep that data separated? And then the other point, and again from experience here, when we talk about the data, where is the data? As in, is it in the US? Is it in the UK? Is it in Europe somewhere? Is it APAC, EMEA? Is it near side? Is it offshore? You know, all of these questions have to be thought through when you look at the supplier management practice. It's not just a case of looking at an organisation and say, well, the risk profile, they're a big company, they're absolutely fine. Well, I would I would advise some caution there in that line of thinking. But certainly have a think about risk in the widest sense. Are there questionnaires, risk questionnaires that are issued out to your third parties? And then the third point I'll just talk about, and I mentioned earlier, was costs. So clearly, services and products need to be cost effective. You're not going to buy a service or a product if it's wildly expensive, if it's costing you more. Why would you do it from a personal perspective? You're certainly not going to do it from a business perspective. So think, are costs in line? Have they been benchmarked? Are you in an organization where there is a requirement to benchmark? Or perhaps, certainly in some industries and some organizations, there is a requirement to tender some of these services on a regular basis. Perhaps it's every 3 years, perhaps it's every five years. Just to go through that benchmarking activity, you go through an RFI, an RFP, a tender process, a due diligence, selection, so on and so forth. Cost is clearly an important driver. But it's also not only just the headline cost that I've seen organisations make a mistake here with, is that an organisation may say this contract is $1 million a year. Okay, so we understand that. As I've dug into more detail on some of the supplier management practices and delved, sort of looked under the bonnet, if you like, don't forget there's fixed costs and there's variable costs. So it's really important not to just consider the annual contractual costs, but things like additional activities, one-off pieces of work, variable costs when you're evaluating a vendor. Look holistically. So you remember the term holistic in terms of ITIL 4? So look at the fixed costs, but also the variable costs. The fixed costs may be very low. What about those variable costs? What about resourcing, for example? So perhaps you have a contract with a service provider. They provide a service to you, and maybe there are some variable costs in there that when you actually look at them, you may think, yeah, they're actually quite expensive. That service provider is maybe tactically providing a loss service to you, but they're making up that money through really expensive variable costs. I've not seen that in every single organization by any far stretch of the imagination, but it's just worth being aware when you look at cost. I mentioned earlier about it's a $10 million contract or it's a $10,000 contract. Okay, but just make sure that's including your fixed and your variable costs. Okay, so I think you've probably guessed by now, supplier management can keep you quite busy, to say the least. So if we look at the ITIL 4 activities, there's a constant cycle. It goes round and round and round with supplier management. It's something that will, in some organisations, there are teams of people, there are departments of people that solely deal with supplier management. In other organisations I've worked in, there isn't a dedicated supplier management practice. Somebody who knows a bit about supplier management. But broadly speaking, and I'm coming from an ITIL 4 perspective here, there's a constant cycle of activities to keep you very, very busy in the supplier management practice. And those typically are planning, they are evaluation of suppliers and contracts, and we spoke about that earlier, the contract negotiation, supplier contract negotiation, categorization. So moving those suppliers into strategic suppliers, operational suppliers, tactical suppliers, And then not any categorization, then just look at how are you going to mark them? How are you going to measure them in terms of their category as to how important are they to your business? Don't always do that on money, as hopefully the conversation a few moments ago will make you think. Are you going to rag base them, perhaps red, amber, green? Red, there is a problem here. Perhaps they're being taken over by a competitor. Perhaps they're just about to go out of business. Who knows? Amber, it's not a problem, but just to be aware of. And green is, yep, it's fine, we're on it. We've got a good level of oversight. There's no problems here. Also think around the due diligence piece. So annual site visits, security questionnaires, for example. And then contract management itself certainly will keep you busy. Warranty management, so managing claims in terms of non-performance, perhaps warranty claims management. And that links very nicely into the next point, which is actually about performance management. So performance management, this is your monthly service review. This is your reporting. This is your SLA, your performance things as to how's it working. Maybe you've got performance for priority one incidents, or priority two, or priority three incidents, or maybe availability or network connectivity to particular locations, or first time fix, whatever it may be. Just that performance management, and typically you will see those come through on a monthly service review. I mentioned it a few moments ago when we talk about performance management, but it also links into the contractual management about watch out for this non-performance clause in contracts. So, i.e. they're not responsible for the performance of whoever that other person is. So maybe you've got a service integrator providing an ecosystem to you, and they are responsible for making sure that end-to-end piece operates. But I've seen in a number of contracts over the years this non-performance piece that actually says, well, okay, although we are doing that end-to-end pace, this particular service provider is exempt to this, and there is a non-performance clause in there. So really just a nod to that more than anything else. And then the other part to supplier management practice is the renewal or termination, perhaps, or maybe there's a novation type activity. So let's talk about service integration. So service integration is responsible for orchestrating all of the service providers, getting them all to work together. So they're all part of the orchestra, if you like, and they are delivering products, they're delivering services end to end. Really important that they're orchestrating service providers to deliver products and services end to end for the customer. There are different models, there are different approaches for service integration. You can do it internally. So if you are the customer, you can be the service integrator internally, or you can work with an external service integrator, perhaps an Indian offshore organization, as an example. I've actually worked in both of those environments. I've worked within service integration from a customer perspective, where I've representing the customer, and I've also worked on the other side of the fence, where I've worked actually for the service integrator. Key phrase around service integration is collaboration. Now, getting that collaboration, it's much easier said than done, I can assure you, but collaboration, making sure there is a common goal that we're all working to deliver to the customer. Assurance and performance management, reporting, relationship management, it all helps steer the direction of service integration. Final point around this is around governance boards. So I'm going to go into a SIAM model in a few moments, and I will talk around some of the roles and the governance type activities. But the really obvious one here is the change advisory board. So making sure that there are proper boards in place that will be able to bring about that service integration. And then finally, still on the ITIL 4 perspective here, let's talk about the service value chain. As a reminder, and hopefully this is ingrained in your brain by now, but the service value chain is part of the service value system. Service value system covers things like guiding principles, the governance element, the service value chain, so that's right at the center of the service value system. The practices, so we're going through these practices at the moment. There's 34 practices split between general management, service management, and technical management. We're talking about the supplier management practice within the general management practice here. And then the final point around the service value system is the continual improvement, all delivering value. So if we just go back to the service value chain for a moment, there are elements within the service value chain. There are activities that are planning, improving, engaging, designing, transitioning, obtaining, building, delivering, and support. All of those items end up delivering products and services and value ultimately to your customer, to your stakeholder. So in that context, and the way I always remember this is PIDOD, P for plan, I for improve, E for engage, D for design and transition, O for obtain and build, and then the other D for deliver and support, PIDOD. In the context of supplier management, the supplier management practice, service value chain is involved in all of those activities, especially planning, engaging, obtaining, building, designing, transitioning, delivering, and supporting. So that's really the headline information around ITIL 4, the ITIL 4 view on supplier management and the supplier management practice, which is from the general management practice. Now, let's take a quick look under the bonnet of something called SIAM. Well, SIAM stands for Service Integration and Management. So SIAM, it's ITSM based, IT Service Management. It's service orientated. Typically, SIAM is used in organizations that have a multi-provider environment. It's typically quite complex. There's lots of service providers. And quite often, the term that it needs attention is kind of bandied around. Organizations that have a multi-provider environment, they're looking for better value. They're looking for better quality. They're looking for better contractual arrangements. They're trying to reduce complexity. I've certainly seen this many times. Too many vendors, too many suppliers, way too complicated. They're looking for better management, better fit, better organizational fit, better cultural fit. Performance, again, another area I've seen quite often, the complexity and the performance, just trying to deliver a better performance. And then just making sure there's a right mix of partners. Collaboration, is a key element of SIAM, and we mentioned this in ITIL 4 a few times as well, that SIAM is very, very strongly collaborative based. It's about that end-to-end focus. As a side note, it's worth just having a look and compare and Google it or look it up in a dictionary, that what is the difference between collaboration and cooperation? I'll leave that out for the moment, but collaboration is all about the shared goal, the shared direction. SIAM typically allows you to simplify really complex operating models for providers. It's not a new thing. In fact, it goes back to about the mid-2000s from the public sector. It has its origins in the UK government, where departments were trying to look at a better way of managing and coordinating and getting better value and better service from IT. It has a global reach, SIAM, as a concept. So UK, Australia, Japan, Scandinavia, US, India, Germany, Netherlands, etc. Just to mention a few locations. It has a global reach. There is documentation, body of knowledge, a BOC, a process guides available. There's certifications, there's accreditations, there's courses, there's training. It's all about helping deliver end-to-end service management. Important point, it helps. So note the word help. It doesn't solve it. SIAM is not the answer to absolutely everything. It helps significantly, and the more you put into it, the more you get out of it. But that it will certainly help deliver end-to-end service management for sure, and I say that from a real world experience. So let's really briefly go through the various models and some of the terminology and some of the models and definitions. You will think, oh yeah, that I've heard that from an ITIL 4 perspective as well. But these are it's important to know ITIL and SIAM are separate. So if we just focus on SIAM for a moment, the four service integrator models, so different ways of operating service integration and management. There's four ways. There's an internal way, there's an external way, there's a hybrid way, and there's a lead supplier. So internal, the customer is taking on the role of the service integrator. So this is internal. This is completely internal within the organization. The customer is the service integrator. They are one of the same. Can be quite challenging that. There definitely needs to be a level of impartiality and being independent, particularly if there's internal service providers there, because the service integrator needs to call to account all of those service providers, and if one of those service providers is also part of the same company, that can cause a complexity there. The other model in the four SI models is external. So this is where a customer typically would appoint an external organization of some kind to perform the role of the service integrator, and their role is exclusively focused on service integration. I have worked for a number of offshore service integrators, but the point there is that their role is exclusively focusing on the service integration piece. Then the third model is called hybrid, and that's typically a combination of the two models I've just mentioned a moment ago. The internal model, where you've got the customer taking on the role of the service integrator, and external, so the customer appoints an external organisation to perform the role of service integrator. Again, exclusively focused on service integration, but the hybrid, as it sounds, it's a combination of the internal and the external model. And then the fourth model is called lead supplier. Now that's the service integrator is also a service provider. The important point here is you need to ensure the service provider has that service integrator capacity and capability, that they're not just saying they can do it. Have they got experience? Do they know the difference? Do they know how to be a service integrator and bring all of those parties together and orchestrate all of those parties? Just a side note, the service integrator, does not have a contractual relationship with a service provider. The role of the service integrator is to provide end-to-end integration. So as an example, I'm going to talk through when we talk about a SIAM model, there's three layers to a SIAM model. And at the top, you have the customer. And the customer will have retained capabilities. So those are capabilities that they want to hang on to and manage internally. You then have the service integrator layer, and their role is one of orchestration, collaboration, end-to-end of the service providers. And then you have the service provider level. So this is where you would typically have multiple service providers providing that service originally, all leading into the customer. And that's where that complexity piece came in earlier. The service integrator sits between the customer and the service provider. So all of those service providers report, if you like, into the service integrator. Service integrators can be internal as well. So it's not unusual that a service integrator will be perhaps looking, a service provider could well just be an application team internally, for example, or it could be an outside external third party providing cloud services or compute services. The customer layer, so this is within the customer organization, it's the end client, and they're moving to the ecosystem, usually on some form of driving strategy. The customer owns the contractual relationships in a SIAM model. So those service provider contracts that are going into the service integrator, the customer owns the contractual relationships. RACI matrix is a really good tool in terms of being able to work out retained capabilities and responsible and accountable parties. So the importance of having a RACI matrix is a really useful tool that if you can get from your customer, the RACI matrix, you're going to understand why retained capabilities are the way that they are, or you know who's responsible, who's accountable, who needs to be consulted, who needs to be informed. The retained capability in the customer is usually a function of some kind. From experience and also from the SIAM guidance, it talks around these retained capabilities within the customer are typically things like governance, oversight, business engagement, architectural services, architectural practices, perhaps enterprise architecture. Anything strategic is usually kept as a retained capability. Procurement, now I've certainly worked in organisations where retained capabilities has very much been procurement. I've also worked in organisations where procurement has absolutely been moved out of house. Enterprise risk, anything risk-based, it's not unusual for that to be a retained capability. There's a huge amount of sense for an organisation to retain enterprise risk. Owning that risk element very much, I would recommend, has to stay with the customer. Outsourcing, if you like, risk sounds quite a dangerous approach. and then contract management as well, CM. So that's an oversight of customer, the C in the model. And then the next layer down, so we've got the customer at the top, and then the next layer down is the service integrator. So that's where all of those service providers are coming into the service integrator, and service integrator is looking at that end-to-end service governance. That's where the governance, the end-to-end service happens. Key functions occur in this space, so delivery, management, coordination type activities, and getting all those various service providers to work together, collaboration, just keep remembering the word collaboration, and then coordinating cross-functional landscapes and ecosystems with all of those service providers to deliver that end-to-end model. And then finally, in the model, you've got the service providers. You'll have lots of service providers there. They could be internal service providers from the customer. They could be external service providers. It could be end user compute. It could be cloud. It could be service desk services. It could be support, BAU, maintenance, application development, etc. It could be a whole host of service providers. They're responsible for managing the products and the services, and it's usually their own products and services, but we need to move this into an ecosystem. The preferred term, just slight aside on this, is service provider. From the SIAM perspective, service provider in the ecosystem. So not vendors, not third parties, not suppliers, it's service providers. And they have their own processes and their own way of operating within the service. And the challenge for the service integrator is about trying to integrate their activities and their processes into the standard way that serves the customer better. So the final final bit around SIAM would be something called the roadmap. So there are four iterative stages within the roadmap. They're discovery and strategy, plan and build, implement, run and improve. And within each of those, there is a whole bunch of activities. It's a planning framework. It determines the structure, guides implementation, sets up robust governance mechanisms, change management, both technical and organizational. And again, you'll see that in ITIL 4 as well. You have the organizational change management within the general management practice, and then you have the change control practice within the service management practice. So it is within SIAM. Change management, you've got the technical management and the governance and the change advisory board, and then you have the organizational changes, and there's an ADCAR model that's really useful in that. And it's a structure for making things more efficient, more effective. I've read it out as discovery and strategy, plan and build, implement, run and improve. It's not always as linear as that, but those are the stages. They have inputs, they have outputs. Okay, so I suppose the final point on SIAM I would mention around roles. So some roles I've seen within SIAM is the SIAM governance lead, the SIAM ops lead, you have process owners, and then you have governance boards and structural elements. I'm going to end this session now. So I've covered ITIL 4 and I've covered SIAM here in terms of supplier management. I hope you found that useful. If you subscribe, that would be very much appreciated, and hit the bell. Thank you.